this first Sunday after the Epiphany, we celebrate the baptism of our Lord. Every year we do that. And so the church designates this day as an especially appropriate day to celebrate the sacrament of baptism. And today at All Saints, we are celebrating both baptism and the sacrament of confirmation this morning. And every time we celebrate either one of these two sacraments, we say together the baptismal covenant, reminding ourselves that we are grafted into the risen body of Christ as living members, and that we are called into this body for a purpose beyond ourselves. And that is to proclaim and embody the good news of God's love for all people. Our presiding bishop, Michael Curry, reminds us that actually we are called into a movement, not so much an institution. Institutions are fine, they serve the movement. But that the early followers of Jesus understood themselves as part of a movement. And Bishop Curry calls this the Jesus movement, which is called to make disciples who will change this world by the power of God's love. Love is what changes the world. If it's not about love, it's not about God. Love changes lives, and love changes this world. I'm reading a book right now about a long conversation between Archbishop Desmond Tutu and the Dalai Lama entitled The Book of Joy. The question is asked of them, how can we have joy in the face of such suffering as we see around the world? And they ask, more pointedly, why are you not morose? And Bishop Tutu and the Dalai Lama have seen their fair share of suffering and pain and destruction, and yet they remain joyful, so they have some credibility for an answer here. And Bishop Tutu says, the more that we turn toward others, the more joy we experience. The goal is not just to create joy for ourselves, but to be a reservoir of joy. To be a reservoir of joy. An oasis of peace. A pool of serenity that can ripple out to all those around you. Love, compassion, generosity, and joy ripple out. Baptized people are called to change this world by the power of God's love. And it is a calling. Everyone here today is called, as we say. The Greek word for church actually means the people called out. By our baptism, we are a people called out beyond ourselves. Now, having said all that, I want to emphasize this morning that baptism is something more than plugging in to the body. It's more than plugging in as part of the body in order to do the work of the church. It's something more than getting an assignment in order to help the body function. Paul writes of the church, certainly he writes of the church as a body, specifically the body of Christ, and each of us is a member of the risen body of Christ, and some are called to be apostles and some prophets and some teachers and so forth. Each member has a calling, a role in all of this, of course. In a sense, we do plug in to serve the body, to build up the body, that's true. But today I want to suggest that this calling is all of those things and more. Your baptism is more than plugging in as a part of the body to do the work of the church. Our calling is more than church work, however noble and valuable and needed. We speak of baptism as a new birth. It is the beginning of a life of conversion to Christ. And it includes a lifelong journey to discover two things. And I imagine there are more than two, but two today. Two things are discovered on this lifelong journey. Our truest selves, and our deepest longings. For we as human beings do have a great thirst for purpose and meaning in our lives. We have a deep desire to connect together our faith and our service. A desire to connect our faith and service actually at the heart level. Now the writer and spiritual director Frederick Buechner defines our true calling, and maybe you've heard this, he defines our true calling as the place where our deep gladness meets the world's deep need. Simply put, if we are honest, we want the two to match. We want our deep gladness and the world's deep need to match. And that is a question of discernment and vocation. Vocation, the word vocation, coming from the Latin word voice. And so we think of discerning vocation as listening for the voice, listening for the calling. Now Parker Palmer, a Quaker, and Quakers do much more listening than speaking, he says that vocation does not mean a goal that I pursue. It means a calling that I hear. Vocation does not come from a voice somewhere out there calling me to something I am not. It comes from a voice in here, calling me to be the person I was born to be, accepting the treasure of the true self I already possess. So true calling, true vocation, intersects with true self. The two meet. In other words, we are not called to be something we are not. We are not called to pretend to be something we are not, even for the noblest and loftiest purposes. We're not called to pretend to be Mother Teresa or Gandhi or Martin Luther King Jr. We're not called to fake it for the highest cause. Rather, we are called to discover and be who we are. Authentic selfhood. Now, I know there are a lot of parents here. Life is full of chores and challenges we don't feel called to do, right? I'm not talking about that. It won't work to say I'm not called to do the dishes. I'm talking about the intersection between authenticity and vocation. Between true self and true calling, not pretending, not faking it, but being who we are and trusting that God wants that and calls us actually to that, that our true nature is called by God for a purpose. Now, Parker Palmer, this previously mentioned Quaker, he has written a little book about vocation entitled Let Your Life Speak. And I recommend it to anyone working through a period of discernment. But he tells a story about this intersection between the true self and a calling to serve God's purposes. It's a story which takes place on December the 1st, 1955, in Montgomery, Alabama. An African-American woman, a seamstress in her early 40s, Rosa Parks, you know the story. Well, she sat down at the front of a bus in one of the seats reserved for white people. A dangerous, daring, provocative act in a racist society. And years later, someone would ask Rosa Parks why she sat down at the front of the bus that day. And her answer is a little surprising and not at all spectacular. She did not say that she sat down to launch a movement. Her motives were more elemental than that. She said, I sat down because I was tired. Palmer suggests she did not mean that her feet were tired. She meant that her soul was tired, that her heart was tired, her whole being was tired of playing by racist rules, of denying her soul's claim to selfhood. He says the moment that she sat down at the front of the bus on that December day, it was a moment of existential truth, of claiming authentic selfhood, of reclaiming her birthright, reclaiming God's gift. And in that moment, she set in motion a process that changed both the lay of the land and the law of the land. Rosa Parks sat down because she had reached a point where it was essential to embrace her true vocation, not as someone who would reshape our society, but as someone who would live out her full self in the world. She decided, I will no longer act on the outside in a way that contradicts the truth on the inside. I will no longer act as if I was less than the whole person I know myself inwardly to be. And perhaps what follows is Palmer's chief point. He says we can look at all the great liberation movements of our times in South Africa, Eastern Europe, among women, African Americans, gays and lesbians, and what we see is simple, but often ignored. The movements that transform us and our world emerge from the lives of people who make a choice for authenticity. In the face of political systems forcing them to live in a way untrue to who they are and risking punishment, they decide to live divided no more. They decide to no longer act on the outside in a way that contradicts some truth they hold deeply on the inside. They decide to claim authentic selfhood and act it out. And their decisions ripple out to change the society in which they live. Palmer calls this the Rosa Parks decision. In 1955, Montgomery, Alabama, who possibly could have dreamed it? Every day, you and I are faced with the same decision. The choice to pretend and fake it, or to claim authenticity, to reclaim our true nature, to reclaim God's gift. One defining moment on a bus ripples out to liberate a land. One defining moment on a cross ripples out to liberate a world. Defining moments and ripples. Isn't that what actually happens at baptism? We enter the waters of baptism, and God creates a ripple. That's true for each one of us as individual members of the body. It's true for the body of Christ. It's true for us, the people of All Saints Episcopal Church in Fort Worth, Texas. We step into the waters of baptism, and true vocation is claimed. Who you were born to be is accepted and claimed. And we participate in what happens next, a ripple effect, as all are liberated by the good news of God's love, which we are called to proclaim and embody in the name of the Holy Trinity, one God in whom we live and move and have our being.